and be glad in it. Amen. We will rejoice and be glad in it. So this morning we give God all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. And I pray this morning that you're here to worship him. Already the ground has been set. It has been saturated with his love. It has been saturated with it, with the worship that we've sent up, where we say, receive this living sacrifice. I am your worship. Receive this living sacrifice. And who is the living sacrifice this morning? We are, because we are the worship. Amen. So we're giving ourselves to the Lord this morning. So as you can see, all the scriptures, all the songs are geared up to the title of this morning's message, which is Erect, Empower, and Expect Your Altar to Speak for You. Erect, empower, and expect your altar to speak for you. Three E's. Erect, empower, and expect your altar to speak for you. Let's pray. Haba, we just want to thank you this morning for your love. We want to thank you, Lord God, for, hallelujah, for loving us this morning. And so we come before your presence to hear from you. Ah, Father, because we need a word from you. And if we don't hear from you, what will we do? So, Father, this morning, we come as a living sacrifice, poured out before you this morning, Lord. Hallelujah. This morning, I pray that you will receive our offering. You will receive us, our praise and our worship. And so, Father, I pray right now that as I decrease and you increase, you have your way this morning. You have your way, Almighty God. I give you all the praise and all the glory. And I say, speak, Father, speak, Lord, because we are here to hear from you. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. This morning's scripture is taken from Exodus 20, verse 24. And it reads as thus. Make an altar of earth for me. Make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, your sheep and your goats and your cattle, wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come to you and bless you. Exodus 20, verse 24, and it reads, make an altar of earth for me. Make an altar of earth, the earth that we are standing on, for me. And the for me is for God. And sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, your sheep, your goats, and your cattle. Wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come to you and bless you. Amen. Well, we're going through the Bible, and I tell you that the passions are real, and the focuses are intentional on the Word of God. And so we're reading both the Old Testament and the New together daily. And so as I'm going through now, I think I'm up to Leviticus with my reading. So I've gone through Genesis and Exodus, and now I'm up to Leviticus. And when I saw the information about the altars, the Lord said, I want you to preach on this just to bring everything into context. So this morning's title is Erect, Empower, and Expect Your Altar to Speak for you. So for those of you that aren't reading as yet or haven't reached where I've reached in the word, I want to bring this to your knowledge this morning. So as you digest the word and you are in the word, this word will become alive and active in your life. So I want to start out by saying, when you reflect on your life, as I did, You can clearly recognize and acknowledge times where God made a way out of no way. My God. You can clearly recognize and acknowledge times where God made a way out of no way for you. He protected you from that accident. He sustained you during challenging times like the pandemic where millions died, but he kept you in your right mind. Hallelujah. He elevated and promoted you when you were unworthy and undeserving. He strengthened you in moments of weakness, mighty God. He guided and brought you through losses this morning. He gave you that special person to love and who loves you in return, flaws and all. My God. He healed you when the report was daunting. He opened up doors and further propelled you to areas where you couldn't imagine and placed you, hallelujah, at tables where you knew that you didn't have a seat. I want you to pause this morning and say, God, I thank you. Glory, hallelujah. I want you to pause and say, God, I thank you. Because all these didn't happen on its own. This was not a mere stroke of luck. It's not a lucky break or coincidence or a buck-up. This is God's goodness on you and I this morning. So when I said what I reflected, I said, God, this is your goodness. This is your loving kindness towards me. This is your hand on my life, God. This is your manifestation, oh my God, of your fullness and your glory. So you need to thank God for his favor this morning. You need to thank him for his mercy, and say, Lord, I am grateful for what you have done. Mighty God of Zion, say, Lord, I am grateful. Lord, I am grateful. This is a grateful heart. This morning before you, this is your grateful daughter coming before you. Lord, I am grateful for what you have done. I'm grateful. I cried through the penning of every word of this message today because, Lord, I am grateful. So great. And through your recognition and acknowledgement and gratefulness, you must build your altar of thanksgiving unto the Lord. What did I just say? Through your recognition, your acknowledgement, and your gratefulness, you must build your altar of thanksgiving unto the Lord and say, Lord, I remember your loving kindness. Lord, I remember your loving kindness. How you brought me out. How you brought me through, Lord. Lord, I thank you. When I grew up with one shoes on my foot. And now I can't even count them. Lord, I thank you. Lord, when all I had for dinner was crackers and tea. And now, Lord, I look in the fridge and I can't even decide what it is that I want. Lord, I thank you. Lord, when I went through that health crisis and the doctors didn't know what to do and how to do, and Lord, how you brought me out because I'm a walking miracle. Lord, thank you. Lord, when my tears were my pillow at night because there was nobody there to love me. But no, Lord, you gave me somebody. Lord, you gave me a Boaz and you gave me a Ruth, Lord. I thank you, Lord God Almighty. Flaws and all, Lord, you gave me somebody. Lord God, when my kids were, oh my God, going crazy. Lord, now I have my children back in their right mind. Lord, I thank you. So I built an altar of thanksgiving unto the Lord. for what he has done. From a grateful heart, I erect that altar. I empower that altar. And I expect that altar to speak for me because it's coming from a grateful heart, a heart of thanksgiving, a heart of recognition and acknowledgement that it was God. Who could it be but God? Hey, it wasn't luck. It wasn't a buck up. It wasn't coincidence. It was God. And so I erect, empower, and expect my altar to speak because it's coming from a heart of thanksgiving and recognition of what God has done for me. So, what is an altar? What is an altar? An altar is a sacred place set apart for God where the man or woman meets and connects with God in and through prayer. An altar is a sacred place set apart for God, where the man and woman meet and connect with God in and through prayer. It is a place of worship and sacrifice. A place set apart oftentimes in your house, in your car, the place where you go and steal away with God. The place that reminds you who God is and when he does things that only he alone can do. It's a reminder. It's a memorial before God. And these are the secret places, the lockaway places. But Jesus himself calls it the closet. He calls it the closet. And that's in Matthew 6, verse 6, where Jesus said, "But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly." So basically, the altar is a place where divinity, God, meets with humanity, meaning you and me. And in the Old Testament, our forefathers marked such significance by building altars to thank God for what he had done. And those altars fueled their faith. They knew that because God did it before, he will do it again. My God, because God did it before. And as they set that memorial, that place where they constantly visited over and over again, it reminded them that God did it before and he will do it again because he's a God of the re. And the re is again and again. So Exodus 20, verse 24 again reads, "Make an altar of earth anywhere you go, because earth. Anywhere you go for me, wherever that place reminds you of the goodness of God, you build an altar there and sacrifice on it your burnt offering and fellowship offerings, your sheep, your goat, and your cattle, wherever I cause my name to be honored, wherever he stamps his approval on that place, I will come to you and bless you." So, in other words, God told the Israelites, build altars into places where I remind you of who I am, and I will bless you there. God will bless you where you build altars. And when you're always thanking God for what he's done, remembering his goodness, talking about how he's made a way where you didn't see any way out, your altar will speak for you. Because while you're thanking God, God says he will bless you. Oh my God. While you're thanking God, he said that he will bless you. So you're there to express your gratitude. And when you're at the altar, God says, I will be good to you, my child. Again, I say, God said, build altars where it reminds you of who he is. It is also a place where God's divine direction is given to enable you to fulfill God's design appointment, his assignment upon your life. It gives you direction and clarity. When you build your altar. So to put it in perspective, like I said, we're in the Old Testament and in the New. In the Old Testament, altars were made with 12 huge stones, where animals were sacrificed as a form of prayer to God. And in the New Testament, under the blood covenant, we are instructed to pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands. Therefore, we do not need stones to build an altar, but rather your altar can be a place in your home where you have set apart and set aside a secret closet to meet with God in prayer on a daily basis. We were talking this week as we were going through the sacrifices, and we said, man, imagine if I was poor, how would I be able to make an offer? If I didn't have the right cattle, the spotless lambs, and depending on the amount of sin that I created in a day, in a week, if I was poor and I didn't have cattle, what would have happened? My God, we marveled at that. They said, God, I thank you for grace. I thank you for grace, God, that I don't have to go out and kill something to sacrifice unto you. Because in the Old Testament, our forefathers sacrificed the flesh of animals and burned them on altars. But in the New Testament, the believers, our flesh are consumed with the fire of the Holy Spirit due to our consistent visitation to the altar or the place of prayer. You see the difference and the shift that just took place? Do you see? In the Old Testament, our forefathers sacrificed animals and burned them on the altar. But in the New Testament, the believer's flesh are consumed with the fire of the Holy Spirit due to the consistent visitation to the altar and our place of prayer. So remember, Solomon built an altar for God in 1 Kings 8, 22 to 61, and prayed. And the Bible says that God answered him with divine fire from heaven, which consumed the altar he had built. Remember when Elijah built an altar and prayed to God in 1 Kings 18, 31 to 38, and God answered him with fire from heaven. And in the New Testament, God might not necessarily answer his people with natural fire, but with a spiritual fire ignited by the Holy Spirit, which lights up every time when men visit the altar to pray to God. That's your fuel, your constant visitation to God. It's ignited through the Holy Spirit every time you commune with the Lord. And that's why the Bible says in Hebrews 12, verse 29, our God is an all-consuming God. And when you visit him, he consumes you. He commune with you, hallelujah. He ignites your spirit, hallelujah. He fills you up, hallelujah. Glory be to God, hallelujah. The secret things about the altar is that one must never refrain from it. There you must be a consistent prayer warrior at the altar. That's why the Bible says we shall pray without ceasing. Never you stop, as it said in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17. Pray without ceasing, because as you pray, you're being consumed with the fire. And it is an offering. It is our sacrifice. It is our shield and defense. It is time invested at the altar and never time wasted. What are you doing with your time? Because it is our offer. My prayer is my offer. It is my sacrifice as I go into war, as I prepare a place where I commune one with me. It is our shield and our defense mechanism. It is my force field that I build because it's my consuming fire. So this morning, the Lord is saying, erect your altars because it's a memorial to him and to you and what he has done. He's brought you through. So the erect your altar is the first key point that I want to sit on for a moment. Because when you erect your altar to speak, God responds. When you erect your altar, it speaks and God responds. Because God actively responds to the activities that happen at the altar. Because every altar speaks. Every altar speaks. It's either blessing or curse, meaning good or evil. Thus, it's important to choose wisely to build God's altar because it's altars of blessings. And in every altar, there must be a sacrifice. In every altar, there is a priest. You are the priest. And the work of a priest is to offer the sacrifice and being the voice of the altar. And when you study the lifestyle of Jesus Christ in the gospel, you discover that he always separates himself from the mass and goes to a secluded place. And the place I call is his altar. And pray to our Heavenly Father. In Luke 5 and verse 16, it says, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Thus he had a deep, abiding relationship with God and had a consistent and persistent communication at the altar. Wow. So I in return do what I've read that Jesus did. Because in order to have a deep abiding relationship with God, I must have a consistent, persistent communication at the altar. Revelation 6, 9 through 10 says, and when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimonies which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwelled on the earth? So from the scriptures, you see that the altar truly does have a voice. Though the souls of these believers have been slain, yet their voices are crying from under the altar. The altar has a voice which often echoes from one generation to another. And many today are benefiting from the altars of their grandparents or parents who prayed fervently and interceded for them to become a people who love and serve God. Many of us can attest to that. That I'm living this moment because of the tears that my mama prayed for me. That my daddy prayed for me. That my grandparents cried over me. So when men might forget, God never forgets the prayer uttered from the altar. When men forget, God never forgets the prayer uttered from the altar. In other words, words directed to God at the altar will always echo from earth into eternity. The prayers you have prayed at the secret place in your home, the tears you have shed in your prayer closet to God to save your loved ones, the intercessions you have made for the body of Christ will forever echo in the heavenly realms from now to eternity. Because God will never forget the prayer uttered from the altar and the sacrifice you paid every time you kneel before the altar and pray to him on behalf of others and yourself. God will never forget. And he will forever reward the voice which utters effectual, fervent prayers at the altar. I pray that you become that voice. I pray that you become that voice which God hears from the altar in your home. Pray fervently for your family. I pray that you become the voice which God hears first thing in the morning, crying out to him, giving him the fruits of your lips, the first fruits of your lips. I pray that you become the voice that cries out loud from the altar into the throne room of God in the heavenly realms. I pray that you become the voice which can never be silent from now unto eternity, because you're crying out consistently, persistently for the Lord. That's erecting your altar and giving it a voice. That's erecting your altar. So how do I empower the altar of God? The second E is empower the altar. So when you empower the altar of God and it speaks, then any other voice from other altars are nullified. That's the importance of empowering your altar. When you empower the altar of God and it speaks, then any other voices from other altars are nullified. They're canceled. Do you understand the importance of empowering your altar? I repeat again. When you empower the altar of God and it speaks, then any other voices from other altars are nullified. They're canceled. Why, Pastor Carleen? 1 Kings 13, verse 2 says, then he cried out against the altar by the word of the Lord and said, O altar, altar, thus says the Lord, behold, a child, Josiah by name, shall be born to the house of David, and on you he shall sacrifice the priests of the high places who burn incense on you, and men's bones shall be burned on you. In other words, your altar hears and it speaks. What is your altar hearing? And what is it speaking? Because your altar hears and it speaks. And when a sacrifice is offered on the altar, it speaks. The altar that receives more sacrifice becomes stronger. Because you see, we can never rise above the level of the sacrifice we offer on the altar. So the question again is asked, what are you sacrificing on the altar? Because we can never rise above the level of the sacrifice we offer on our altar. I want you to really underscore that. We can never rise above the level of the sacrifice we offer on our altar. So what are you sacrificing on your altar? Because the altar that receives more sacrifice becomes stronger. Numbers 22, 1 through 3 says, then the children of Israel moved and camped in the plains of Moab on the side of Jordan across from Jericho. Now Balak, the son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites, and Moab was exceedingly afraid of the people because they were many, and Moab was sick with dread because of the children of Israel. So the Israelites decided to move forward. And that's what offended Moab. And it followed that Balak looked for Balaam to build an altar and release a curse. What did I say? They're good altars and they're bad altars. They're blessings and they're curses. And we're reminded in Genesis 22, 15 to 17, which says, the angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand in the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the city of their enemies. So the angel spoke after Abram placed the sacrifice of a son. It's an altar only that can speak to another altar. Underscore that. It takes an altar to speak to another altar. So when you say trouble is in your life, hey, read between the lines. So it takes an altar to speak to another altar. When you say trouble is in your life, read between the lines. Because it takes an altar to speak to another altar. And if you haven't built an altar, hey, read between the lines. Let the spirit of discernment reach you this morning. Therefore, Numbers 23, 1 through 2. Then Balaam and Balak built seven altars for me here and prepared for me here seven bulls and seven rams. And Balak did just as Balaam had spoken. And Balak and Balaam offered a bull and a ram on each altar. So Balaam needed seven altars because they understood that we can never rise above the level of the sacrifice we offer on our altar. So they build the seven altars because the higher the sacrifice, the stronger the voice. My God, my God, my God. Hey. Balaam needed seven altars because they understood that we can never rise above the level of the sacrifice we offer on our altar. So they built seven altars because the higher the sacrifice, the stronger the voice. The higher the sacrifice, the stronger the voice. When trouble is in your life, hey, where's your sacrifice? Is your sacrifice stronger? Because the higher the sacrifice, the stronger your voice. The stronger your voice. So to empower the altar, we must stand in prayer with the altar. Are you standing in prayer with your altar? You must honor that altar. And you must defend the altar. Because our altars are maintained by our sacrifice. Your altars are maintained by your sacrifice. So, what is your sacrifice? How are you empowering your altar? How are you doing that? Judges 6, 25 to 26 says, that same night the Lord said to him, take the second bull from your father's herd, the one 7 years old. Tear down your father's altar to Baal. Because for God to help, he instructed that the present altar must be destroyed and an altar raised for him and a sacrifice offered. Some of you are operating on your old salvation, what you used to do. God is saying, I need a new one. What have you done for me lately? Because we've been in this race so long that we think we can be on cruise control. So when you go back to Judges 6 and 25, that same night the Lord said to him, take the second bull from your father's herd, the one 7 years old, tear down your father's altar to Baal. So for God to help, he instructed that the present altar must be destroyed and an altar raised for him and a sacrifice offered, a new one. For God to bring a change to your situation, he's instructing you to tear down the current altar and raise a new one to him that speaks aloud. Hope somebody's hearing me. He's instructing you to tear down the current altar because it's not enough. That sacrifice is not enough. It's not speaking aloud. And raise a new one to him that speaks aloud. Again, how do I know this is true? Going back to my original text, Exodus 20, verse 24. Make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it wherever I cause my name to be honored. I will come to you and bless you. In other words, God will bless you where you build and erect altars. And when you are always thanking him for what he's done, because you're remembering his goodness, and your altar will speak for you. Because while you're thanking God, God says he will bless you. As you thank me, I'm blessing you. And when you're at the altar, God says, I'll be good to you. My God, you see how he's speaking unto you. Altars are indeed important. Let me just run down a couple of stories real quick. In Genesis 6, chapter 6 and chapter 7, God told Noah that there was going to be a great flood. He was to build an ark and to take 7 pairs of every kind of clean animal. I used to skip over to the part that says two of every kind, but when we, because of our Bible reading, my God, to take 7 pairs of every kind of clean animals, a male and its mate, and 1 pair of every kind of unclean animal, a male and its mate, and also 7 pairs of every kind of bird, male and female, and to keep their various kinds alive throughout the earth. So the flood came, because nobody listened. But Noah built the ark nonetheless. So the flood came, wiped out everything except Noah, his family, and those animals. And after the water rescinded, they opened the door to dry land, and Noah and his family walked off. I want you, I'm pulling you back in. What is the first thing Noah did? What is the first thing Noah did? The first thing Noah did was build, erect an altar. He took time to thank God that he made it. He and his family were preserved. He thanked God that he spared their lives. He thanked God for showing them mercy. He thanked God for his faithfulness. And my prayer is, God, help us to be like Noah. When we see God's favor,
God gives us the victory, when God brings us through tough times and cause us to defeat our giants, that the first thing we do is build and erect an altar. Because we recognize God's goodness and acknowledge his mercy. My God of Zion, this morning. So when God heard Noah giving him praise, the scripture says God promised that he would never flood the earth again. Do you understand the importance of your altar? When God heard Noah giving him praise, the scripture says God promised that he would never flood the earth again. And there are times like with Noah, when you build that altar, you thank God for what he brought you through. God will say, you will never have to go through that again, my child. You will never have to endure that again. You will never have to go back to turn Carmel. Oh my God. You will never have to only have one pair of shoes. You will never have to go back to one pair of pants. My God, God will say, you will never have to go through that again. Because of the altar that you built before God, he put an end to what hindered you. And today, we don't have to do it physically like our forefathers did. It's simply acknowledging God's goodness. It's taking time to say, Lord, I thank you for healing me from that sickness. I thank you. I know it wasn't just the medicine, God. Because of God, you are my healer. I thank you, God, for turning my child around. Thank you, God, for preserving my job. Oh, God, because you are my source and my resource. When others are being laid off, God, oh, my God, I could have been next. But, God, you shifted. My God, and you preserved me. I thank you, God, for giving me beauty for ashes. Oh, God, I recognize your hand of favor upon my life. You open up doors I never thought that I could ever dream of. But you open up the door and cause us to defeat our enemies, Lord. I thank you. I thank you, God. I thank you. I thank you for your loving kindness. Oh, God, that you will never repeat what I've been through. Oh, the hell that I went through. Mighty God, hallelujah. I thank you, God, that because of the altar that I've erected and built before you. Oh, God, you said I would never have to experience that again. My God, my God, my God, my God, wherever you are, just lift your hands towards heaven this morning and give God a praise offering, because our God is awesome. Mighty God, mighty God. The other point is reminding God who he is, reminding him who he is. So in the Old Testament, when the people were facing large difficulties, their prayers would start by reminding God who he is and thanking him for what he had done. They will go back and look at their altars and the times in the past where God made a way. This is what King Jehoshaphat did. He and the people of Judah were surrounded by three powerful armies, and they were outnumbered 10-1. He called the people together and they met in the main courtyard. He looked up to the heavens and said in 2 Chronicles 20:6-7, oh Lord, you are powerful and mighty. No one can stand against you. Are you not the God that drove the inhabitants out of this land? Are you not the God that gave this land to our ancestors, Abraham? Are you not the God that provided us this temple to worship in? My God, they reminded God of all their past victories. They look back at all those altars they had built, and they fuel their faith. They knew if God did it back then, he would do it again. Mighty God, for all of us have some of these but God moments and stories, because when you look back over your life, you need to remember what God has done. Am I not God that brought you through the pandemic? Am I not the God who puts you at the right place, at the right time to make that connection? Am I not God who turned your child around? Am I not God? Sometimes you erect the altar simply for the fact that you are still here. Because God is good. The enemy couldn't finish you off. You may be up against some tough obstacles, and many of us are, but God is saying, am I not the God who parted the Red Sea? Am I not the God who closed the mouths of the lions? Am I not the God who fed 5,000 men plus their wives and children with only 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fishes with 12 baskets of food remaining? Am I not the God who said, peace be still, and the winds and the waves obey him? Am I not the God who raised Lazarus after 4 days? My God, am I not the God who healed the woman with the issue of blood after 12 long years? Am I not the God who caused the blind to see, the deaf to hear, and the lame to walk? Am I not the God who delivered and cast out demons? Am I not the God who brought you this far, protected you, promoted you, favored you, made ways where you didn't see a way out? Am I not the God? So when you look back, it reminds you who God is. And you thank him for what he's done. He says he'll bless you. At the altar, you are built and erected before him. So don't miss out on favor. Don't miss out on your healing and your ever protection, because you're not building altars. But if you don't have an altar, you're missing out. You're missing out on favors. You're missing out on blessings. You're missing out on healings. You're missing out on his protection. Because the altar speaks. The altar speaks. Genesis 12, God told Abraham that he was going to become the father of many nations, that his descendants would own all the land, and that he was going to be blessed and become a great blessing. When Abraham heard this promise, verse 8 says, he built an altar and worshiped the Lord. Verse 8 said he built an altar and worshiped the Lord. But what's interesting is the promise hadn't come to pass. He wasn't a father. His wife, Sarah, was still barren. They didn't have any children. He wasn't greatly blessed yet. And he didn't own any land. Yet he built an altar simply to thank God for what he promised. So this is showing us a principle. Don't wait for the promise to come to pass. Thank God in advance of what he said he will do. God, you said my children will be mighty in the land. God, you said my husband is the head and not the tail. God, you said he will be a lender and not a borrower. God, you said he is a man of valor. There may not be any signs of it just yet. In fact, it's trending in the wrong direction. So you say, when it comes a reality, then I'll thank God. No! Do like Abraham, build your altar now. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, before you see the promise. That is what faith is all about. Now, faith is a substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not yet seen. Because when God sees you at the altar, when he hears you thanking him and praising him and declaring his goodness, that's when you activate the angels to go to work. That's when doors open. That's when your healing comes. That's when favor is released. Lord, you said, I would lend and not borrow. You said my cup will run over. You said I will have a bountiful year. That's the promise. Now build the altar. Lord, thank you that you are my provider. Lord, thank you that you have supernatural increase and it's being released on me. Father, I thank you that you take pleasure in prospering me. Lord, thank you for restoring health back into me as you said that you would heal my wounds. Lord, thank you that I am healed. Thank you that I will run and not be weary. Thank you, my God, that health, energy, and vitality is flowing from me. My God, that's what we need to do. That's it right there. Because how do I know the principles are true? The scripture said, Abram, which became Abraham, left that place where he built that altar and traveled to a different city. And he became very blessed with cattle, silver, and gold, and he saw the promises come to pass. Well, his nephew Lot and all of his flocks were with him. The land couldn't support them both. He told Lot to choose wherever he wanted to go, and Abraham would relocate. Lot chose the best part of the land. The place with plenty of springs and lush pastures looked like a garden, but Abram got stuck with just the opposite. His land was dry, not nearly as desirable, didn't seem fair. Abraham should have gotten to choose, but he took the high road. And after this disappointment, after he was having to start all over, God came to Abram and said in Genesis 13, 14 to 18, Abraham, look around. Far as you can see, I'm going to give you that land for you and your descendants. What did Abraham do? The scripture said he built an altar and worshiped the Lord. He didn't have the land yet because he was discouraged coming off of that disappointment. But he began to thank God for what he promised because he knew the power of an altar. He didn't wait for the fulfillment, for the provision, for the land to become his. He thanked God in advance. Could that be your problem? That you're waiting for the manifestation before you thank God? The last example I'll bring before you is Genesis 27, where Jacob was dishonest. He cheated Esau out of his birthright. He tricked his father into giving him the blessing that belonged to his older brother Esau. When Esau found out, he was furious, so Jacob had to flee for his life. He went far away and worked for his uncle Laban, all the while in hiding, hoping Esau wouldn't find him. 20 years went by and Jacob wanted to return home, and he didn't know what Esau would think or do. So he sent messengers to tell Esau that he wanted to see him, and Esau agreed. Their two parties met on the road with incredible fury because he didn't know what his brother was going to do after years of what he had done initially. Well, Esau walked over and reached out both arms and hugged Jacob. He kissed him. And then Esau went over and hugged Jacob's wives and children. Here's a connecting point, like I said, to the rechargers and the team. I said, their connection, watch it. As you're reading, what are the patterns? I believe there was an aha moment because little Joseph was there. And Jacob, who is Jacob's young son, And he's watching all of this take place. And he'd been so worried for his dad because of what his father was saying about his older brother. And he'd heard so many stories about the feud between his father and Esau. And he was expecting the worst. Everybody was expecting the worst, because remember, Jacob split his camp in two in the event there was going to be war. But Esau told Jacob to follow him and he would lead the way home. And when Jacob arrived, the scripture said, Jacob built an altar there and named it El Roho, which means the mighty God. Jacob didn't just take it for granted and think, oh, I'm lucky I missed that one. No, he built an altar and said, this was the Almighty God. Because this was something greater than he could ever imagine. In Genesis 35, verse 1, then God said to Jacob, go up to Bethel and settle there and build an altar there to God who appeared to you when you were fleeing from your brother Esau. Little Joseph, I said, would see these altars that his father built out of thanksgiving to God for resolving the conflict, restoring the relationship. Let's fast forward about 30 years. Now, Joseph was second in command to all of Egypt. There's a great famine in the land. His brothers came to the palace to purchase food, and these were the same brothers that threw him in a pit years earlier and eventually sold him as a slave to the Egyptians. And the brothers that were so jealous, they betrayed him and made his life what they thought was miserable at the time. Now they were standing before Joseph, but they didn't recognize him. As most of us, this could have been our defining moment to have that big opportunity to get the ultimate revenge and payback. But Joseph's mind reflected on his uncle's forgiveness of his brother, Joseph's father, Jacob. He remembered the altar his father erected that spoke aloud, that said to him, am I not the God who brought peace when you should have had conflict? Am I not the God who caused Esau to forgive? Am I not the God who showed your father mercy for his mistakes? The God who gave him a second chance? Joseph could have gotten revenge. Instead, he treated his brothers like Esau treated his father. He forgave them. He was kind. And he had them all come to Egypt and live. Because when you are constantly building altars, recognizing God's goodness, thanking him for what he's done, it's not just affecting you. It's affecting your children. It's affecting your grandchildren. All of your generations it will affect. Because what if Jacob had not built that altar? What if he thought, I got lucky today? Esau didn't destroy me. We wouldn't be talking about Jacob or probably Joseph, because Joseph would have never seen that defining moment that happened between his uncle and his father, because he had the same thing done to him. He reflected on God's goodness. Am I not the God who brought peace when you should have had conflict? The altar spoke aloud in that defining moment. Are you building altars? What are the altars that you're building? Because if you're not building altars, are you missing faith? Are you missing blessings? Are you missing breakthroughs? Because God said, at the place you build an altar, he's going to bless you. He's going to bless you At the altar, things are settled because your altar is superior to the forces of darkness in your life. The altar protects. The altar promotes. It projects the word of God. And it projects it right into your life. God has spoken promises to all of us. He's whispering in your spirit promises that you see or seem to think it's impossible. And your question to God is, how can I accomplish that dream? How can I get well? How can my family be restored? The answer is, you have the promise. Got to tell you, you have the promise. Now do your part and build the altar. Thank God that it's on the way. Remind him of his goodness. Go back over some of your book God stories and make them personal. Are you not the God who opened that door I couldn't open? Are you not the God who prospered me despite how I was raised? Are you not the God who freed me from that addiction? That blessed me with a spouse, that preserved me in the pandemic, that turned my child around, that caused my business to remain relevant and flourishing today? Are you not the God? When you look back at the altars you built, you thank God for what he's done. And it becomes fuel for your soul and your faith. I know many of you this morning can resonate with one or all of my examples. So I want you to pause this morning and just utter, God, I recognize this. God, I recognize you in my life. That your mighty hand is all over my life. I give you all the praise, God. I give you all the honor, God. God, you did it before, and you will do it again. God, here I am. My altars are erected before you. Are you not the God? You have done it before, God. And I know that you will do it again. You parted the Red Sea. God, do it again for me. By your stripes I am healed, God. So the sickness I'm going through, God, is no match for you, because I've seen you done it before. Are you not the God? Yes, you are. You've done it before, God, and I thank you. You've done it before, God, and I give you praise. I give you honor. And God, you will bless me in due season and in due time. This morning, I pray that you receive that word. Erect, empower, and expect your altar to speak for you. What is your sacrifice? What is your sacrifice? Have you erected those altars in your life as a memorial before God, thanking him for his goodness, for the book God experiences and stories that you have? And because God did it before, he will do it again. This morning, I pray that this is a transformational message, straight from glory, a rhema word, a right now word, to equip you for such a time as this. To change your name, to change your story, to change your path and your trajectory in life. I pray that you receive the word of the Lord. Father, this morning, I thank you for your download. I thank you for your word, Father, that is sustenance to our soul. Father, I pray this morning, Lord God, that as we erect, empower, and expect our altars to speak that we have erected and built before you, Lord. I pray that it will speak aloud. Father God, it will nullify every other voice, every other altars that are in operation this morning. That, Lord, as we erected, Lord God, our sacrifice, Lord God, will be raised before you, and our sacrifice, Lord, will continue to speak and make aloud, oh God, hallelujah. I will nullify every other voice, every other altar that's being presented, Lord. So this morning, I thank you for the reminder, Lord God Almighty. I thank you for the blessing. I thank you for what you have done, Lord God, and what you are about to do as we erect it and bring it up to you, Lord God, this morning. Father, we thank you because are you not the God? Yes, you are. You are the God that parted the Red Sea. Yes, you are. You are the balm in Gilead. Yes, you are. You are the one that healeth thee. You are the great I am. You are the deliverer. You are the faithful one. And so this morning, because you have done it before, God, yes, I give you praise. Yes, I give you thanks, Lord. And I praise you in advance for what you are doing. And so as we erect our altars before you, I pray that it will speak and it will speak aloud. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all of the honor. Bless your children this morning. Hallelujah. Anoint them afresh. Hallelujah. To heed unto your call and to hear your words. We seal this prayer right now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. And we say, amen and amen. I pray this morning that you heard and you receive the blessing of the Lord. Erect, empower, and expect your altar to speak for you. Erect, empower, and expect your altar to speak for you. Have an amazing first day of the week. And if you haven't done it before, begin to build your altars. And remind God of what he has done and what he's about to do. Because he did it before and he'll do it again. God bless you, everyone. God bless you. This is Pastor Carleen from Recharge Ministries. God bless.